All right, everybody. Today we are going to talk about the physical assessment and the diagnostic workup and how I think about patients who are suffering with chronic pain. We got our Topo Chico here, and let's get into it. Okay, so there are many different components that are going to go into how I think about working up a patient who is suffering in chronic pain. Now, to caveat this, we're limiting this discussion to patients who have degenerative orthopedic conditions, so things like tendinosis, tendinopathy, chronic ligament laxity or ligament sprains, osteoarthritis, degenerative disc disease, foraminal stenosis, central stenosis, those types of stuff, along with kind of the more sports medicine type injuries, so tendinitis, we can have the chronic or even acute neurogenic inflammation, those types of things. So with that being said, the first thing that I believe is crucial is hearing the patient's story. This is really, really important because it helps get an understanding of how this came to be. It is near impossible to figure out the root cause of something if you don't know how something started in the first place. So if somebody says to me, oh, you know, my back pain started about 5 years ago, and I say, and I don't know why that started, it makes it very hard for me to understand why it might have started in the first place if I don't ask. So the first question is, okay, well, what happened at that time? Somebody says, nothing. It just started out of the blue. That sets us down a potentially particular path for our diagnostic workup. Now, if somebody says, oh, I was deadlifting in the gym, now that sets us down a different path with potentially different structures, different mechanism of injury, and potentially different treatment options at the end of the day. And so that is always really, really important to understand. So first is hearing the story. Secondly is getting clarification on the story with certain things. In particular, what I am looking for is what things make the pain worse, so specific movements, specific activities, if there's a stress component to it, all of those types of things, what makes the pain better. So when somebody is in a pain flare or they're having pain, or there are particular positions that they can get into, or there are different things that they can do, whether that is a therapy or an exercise or something to that effect that can make it better. What treatments have been tried in the past? Here we're looking at chiropractic care, physical therapy, massage, body work, fascial work, all that type of stuff. Also really want to know about medications that have been tried and if they were helpful. So knowing if somebody has tried ibuprofen and it wasn't helpful might start to send us down potentially a neurogenic pathway. So there might be nerve involvement. Or if somebody had a very, very positive response to ibuprofen or something like an NSAID, then that helps us to know, okay, maybe there is a larger inflammatory component here for our traditional structures, tendons, ligaments, joints, things like that. Any interventional treatments tried? This is really, really important for me because I'm going to be doing interventional procedures with these patients. But if somebody says, oh yeah, I had medial branch blocks, which are the injections to the medial branch, which is going to innervate the facet joints, either in the cervical, thoracic, or lumbar region. And if they say, those did absolutely nothing for my pain, then there's a good possibility or a high chance that the facet joints are not involved, and I'm going to shift my focus onto other areas. Now, I'm obviously still going to evaluate that because I don't trust anything with 100% certainty if somebody else has done it in the past. I always have a little bit of skepticism because I need to make sure that I'm not putting myself in a box and potentially missing something, because who knows, maybe that provider just didn't do a good medial branch block, and because of that, they didn't actually get a good blockage of that medial branch, therefore they didn't get a good diagnostic test of the facet joint. You know, if somebody says, oh, I had a, let's say, a sacroiliac joint injection, and that resolved my pain for 3 months and then it came back, got a winner, that tells me something really, really important, that their sacroiliac joint is likely involved in this pain. And so those are gonna be really, really important to know. And then obviously any surgical history that the patient has had, that's gonna be crucial to know, because we're gonna wanna know, have there been any structural changes in the area, right? If somebody has a laminectomy, for an example, they're missing a piece of bone, and so that might be important in our workup, or especially important in our interventional approaches, because we have to be aware of that and be cautious of that. So from there, and then we also want to know if the surgery helped, right? If somebody had a laminectomy and that improved their pain for 2 years, and then that pain came back, but that pain came back a little differently, that goes, huh, okay. So maybe central stenosis was a big component of their pain initially, but now things are a little bit different. Then after that, we are gonna move into the physical assessment. This is an assessment where we are going through different components. We're going through range of motion. So we wanna know what happens when you look down. Do you have any pain? What happens when you look up, left, right? All the different ranges of motion that a joint can do. Some joints we're only gonna do active. For example, the neck, generally we're doing active. Some joints we'll do both active and passive, meaning active, the patient actually does the moving, and then passive is where the provider or myself will actually do the moving. So we do range of motion. We're gonna do different orthopedic tests. There are tests that are designed to try and stress certain tissues to rule in or out certain conditions. Now, some of these tests are okay. Some of these tests are terrible in terms of their diagnostic accuracy, their sensitivity, their specificity for ruling in or ruling out a particular condition. And there is no one single test that is the only test that we have to do or anything like that. What we're doing is we're taking a large compilation of these tests, and we're using our clinical experience, we're using our understanding of these tests, we're using our understanding of anatomy in order to try and understand what these tests mean. So for example, the number of orthopedic tests we might do for a patient who's having a low back pain, you know, might be anywhere between, if we're, you know, considering doing it on both sides, we're doing 15 to 25 different provocative maneuvers to try and ascertain, okay, what structures, when I physically stress them, might be contributing to this patient's pain. Now, what's really, really important with this part is that we're not just looking for, is this painful? We're looking for, is this your pain? We are trying to recreate the familiar pain from the patient. Sometimes we have a patient who has sacroiliitis, that's our final diagnosis, we've treated it, they get better, all is well and good. But in the physical exam, when we tested their facet joints, they had some pain. On asking them, is this your pain? They go, no, this is different. That's higher up than the pain that I'm here to see you for and hopefully get help with. That's really crucial, because if we don't ask that clarifying question of, is this your familiar pain? Then we might be misled on the diagnosis, and we might treat something that doesn't actually need to be treated because it's not actively causing them pain. Could it in the future? Yeah, of course, but that's not why they're here. They're here to help with their current pain. Then we have different neurological tests. So if we think there's any nerve involvement, whether that's central, something like a nerve root impingement or something to that effect, we test dermatomes, we test myotomes. If there is we suspect any peripheral neurogenic inflammation, then we're gonna be doing different physical tests for that, whether that's palpation-based, sometimes they're movement-based, things like that. Then we obviously palpate. So we're actually gonna apply pressure on different areas, mainly where tendons and ligaments are attaching onto the bone, called the enthesis, and we're going to see if that reproduces any of their pain. Again, really important to understand, is this just painful, or is this recreating your pain? Is this familiar? We also wanna then understand if something is hyperalgesic or if there is allodynia. Hyperalgesic meaning a normally painful stimulus causing excessive amounts of pain or increased amounts of pain. In that situation, generally we have to compare one side to the other. And then the allodynia is where we have a normally non-painful stimulus that now causes pain. Obviously, if we start working over or start seeing the allodynia, we have to consider CRPS. But most of the time when we see allodynia, it's not CRPS. It is just some peripheral sensitization that is occurring because the peripheral cutaneous nerves are involved. From there, if there's imaging or if we need imaging, we then, you know, either perform a diagnostic ultrasound or we order imaging, or we are going to look at their imaging to see if what matches up. So patient comes in, it seems like they have pain coming from their L4, L5 facet joint. We then look at that under imaging. We see some hypertrophy at that level. We see that, okay, those potentially match up. That is, in essence, the diagnostic workup. From there, we have our differential diagnosis and we try to move forward with our therapeutic approaches, whether that is an interventional approach, the nerve hydrodissection, a prolotherapy injection, platelet plasma injection, adipose or bone marrow tissue injections, Or we look to refer out for physical therapy or another type of modality that we think the patient would actually do better with and doesn't currently need to undergo the interventional approaches. So that is, in essence, how we think about the diagnostic workup for a patient suffering with orthopedic and sports medicine type pain and injuries. I truly, truly hope that this was helpful for you, and I hope you'll have a wonderful day. See ya.